Okay, so today I'm going to talk about mirror symmetry. And I'm going to try to cover four aspects of it. Mirror symmetry from the world sheet point of view, mirror symmetry from the space-time point of view, the Strominger-Yau-Zassel construction, and the Gross-Siebert program. And homological mirror symmetry. So that's a lot for 2 hours. I'm not sure exactly how much of it I'll get through, but I'm going to try. So I talked about a number of different dualities last time, and one of the interesting dualities that I didn't manage to touch on last time is this duality known as mirror symmetry. So mirror symmetry is about, generally speaking, Calabi manifolds. And let me remind you of two key features of a Calabi manifold from the point of view of string compactification. The first is that so Calabi manifold means a manifold with a particular metric, a type of metric on it. The types of metrics that were conjectured to exist by Calabi and proven to exist by Yau, which is why there's the name. And so a Calabi metric has a covariantly constant spinner field. So it's a spin manifold for one thing. There's a spinner field which is covariantly constant. And that's useful for preserving some amount of supersymmetry when you compactify a highly supersymmetric theory, such as the string theories or supergravity theories, down to lower dimensions. In the higher dimensional theory, the geometric analog of these supersymmetry operators that we've been talking about on the world sheet level live as spinner fields on spacetime. And so if we can keep one of those spinner fields covariantly constant with respect to the metric, we have some possibility of some surviving supersymmetry transformation in the effective theory. And then that property turns out to be very closely related to the fact that the metrics are Ricci flat, and so satisfy the equations of motion of general relativity with zero cosmological constant. So these two things are very closely related. I don't really have a lot of time to review the story of holonomy of Riemannian manifolds, but let me just say one word. So if you have a Riemannian manifold, there's an interesting operation you can do. If you follow a path on the Riemannian manifold, then there is a notion of parallel transport of various kinds of tensor objects around that path. And in particular, you can parallel transport the tangent space itself, and you'll come back to some other version of the tangent space. So there's parallel transport. If you have a loop gamma, we'll map the tangent space at a point to itself, and it has to preserve the Riemannian structure, so that transformation has to live, and it should preserve the orientation as well, so that transformation has to live in the orthogonal group of this tangent space. But for very special metrics, it actually lives in a subgroup. So if there's a subgroup, G, which is preserved by all such paths, and of course you could vary the definition depending on whether you only want to study contractible paths or want to study all paths. But there's a group there, and if that group is not equal to the orthogonal group, we say the thing has restricted holonomy. And then there was a classification of possibilities. So the classification is not just, it's a group plus a representation, right? And the classification has ordinary Riemannian manifolds, so there's the possibility of SO. This is general Riemannian geometry. You could have a unitary group, which corresponds to Kähler geometry. You can have a special unitary group, which is now called Calabiau. You can have an SP group, which is called hyperKähler. You can have SP times S1, SPN times SP1, which is very confusingly named quaternion Kähler. It has neither a quaternion structure nor a Kähler structure, but anyway, that's what they call it. Then there are two special cases, G2 and spin 7. And there's another thing which isn't sometimes neglects to be mentioned, which is a space of the form gamma mod G, a symmetric space of the form gamma mod G, where gamma is I should call it H mod G, but that's, I can't think of a letter, K mod G maybe, where it gets that structure just by virtue of being a symmetric space. So the symmetric space cases are a story among themselves, but if you don't have a locally symmetric space, then these are the possibilities. And if you ask about a covariantly constant spinner and Ricci flat, both of these are conditions which will restrict, sorry, Ricci flat does not restrict the holonomy. Ricci flat is a consequence, but covariantly constant spinner restricts the holonomy. And Calabiau, hyperKähler, G2, sorry, this is spin 7, and spin 7 all have covariantly constant spinners, and they're all Ricci flat. So these are the cases that are really of interest if you want to compactify string theory, preserving supersymmetry, and end up with Minkowski space vacuum at the end. That's what the zero cosmological constant part is about. Okay, so K3 is can be seen as hyperKähler because it's SP1, or you can think of SP1 as SU2 and regard it as a Calabi-Yau manifold. Either way is fine. Right, so that's from sort of the world sheet perspective, as it were. Now, the mirror symmetry observation, I'm going to state it as a property of these compactified string theories. Initially, that's not the historical order in which it was discovered. Then I'll back off to a world sheet description where the dimension doesn't matter. I can make a mathematical formulation of the space-time description where the dimension doesn't matter. It certainly seems to be a mathematical feature which is valid in a lot of dimensions, but its origins are in this problem. So mirror symmetry proposes that if I have a Calabi-Yau manifold whose complex dimension is odd, there may be a mirror, X mirror, with the property that the 2A theory on X is isomorphic to the 2B theory on X mirror. And in its strongest form, you would probably also postulate that the 2B theory on X mirror, on X, is isomorphic to the 2A theory on X mirror. So you would have this pair of statements relating these two guys. Now, when I say it's isomorphic, it's a duality such as the ones we had last time needs to discuss a parameter mapping. So each of these spaces depends on parameters in some way. So here there's some parameter space, and over here there's some parameter space. And what I really mean is that I've also got to identify limits in the parameter space where this mirror phenomenon is occurring. So these are just like the R goes to zero and R goes to infinity limits where the natural limits for T duality, there are going to be some limits which typically can be regarded as boundary points on the moduli space for these Calabi-Yau manifolds, which makes the mirror story work. And then if the mirror story is working, it'll work in a neighborhood of those limits, and you can sort of argue that, well, if you have this parameter space for this compactified string theory over here and that one over there, it should extend to the full parameter spaces. Those extensions become interesting because, unlike the cases I discussed yesterday, there are interesting quantum corrections to the naive geometric picture that I'm presenting here. So I talked about what's basically a classical or semi-classical approximation to the compactified theory, where I used geometric data of the compactifying manifold to produce parameter spaces for the, in other words, the possible values of scalar fields, which indicate parameter spaces for the compactified theory. But in fact, and in general, you would expect some kinds of quantum corrections to that classical picture. But it happens that there was so much supersymmetry in all the examples that occurred on Wednesday that I didn't need to worry about quantum corrections. But here, quantum corrections are going to be a big part of the story. So there are quantum corrections from the space-time perspective that I'm discussing now. There are quantum corrections from the world sheet perspective, which I'll come to in a moment when I properly start my outline. There's another version of it when the dimension is even. We'll see in a couple of minutes why there's this distinction. There may be a mirror in this case. And in this case, the 2a on x will actually be the 2a on x mirror. And you know, there's a kind of weak form where you would only assume one of these two statements for a given pair, and then there's stronger forms where you might assume that that all of the statements are true for a given geometric pair. And the same caveat applies, that we've got to talk about appropriate limit points in the moduli spaces that we're discussing. So I already alluded to the role of mirror symmetry. Well, let's see. So if the dimension is 1, then x is just a circle or one torus, whatever you want to call it. And we're just talking about the t-duality story that we already had, where 2a compactified on a circle and 2b compactified on a circle were isomorphic to each other if you map the parameters correctly. So the parameter space or moduli space, in this case, is just r on both sides, but you have to map the radius of 1 to 1 over the radius. Different boundary points in that effective theory correspond to different effective string theory descriptions. In the case of dimension 2, the only real, we could consider other tori, but other tori end up reproducing this t-duality story. So I won't worry about tori again. So the other case of a Calabi manifold in dimension 2 is the K3 manifold that I discussed last time. And here, there's only one kind of thing. So that if mirror symmetry is going to be true, there's only one type of thing you can get as the mirror, namely the K3 manifold again. And what mirror symmetry is going to do, similar to the story of S-duality from type 2b, it will identify the limit at one boundary point with a limit at another boundary point. And if you think about that, that means that this whole little region and this whole little region have to be identified with each other. So the parameter space that I'm now referring to is the one I would have naturally gotten just from the geometric parameters, such as when I did the 2a on K3, what I found was this space 0420 mod 04 cross 020, modulo a parabolic group. And if you just take the space modulo a parabolic group, then you can find different boundary points that are identified by mirror symmetry. So the role of mirror symmetry here is to enlarge the discrete group by which I'm supposed to take the quotient in order to understand the parameter space, just like the role of the S-duality in the type 2b theory that I just discussed was to enlarge what you might have thought was just the integers shifting tau by integer values in the upper half plane to the entire SL2z, which gave a much more interesting quotient. Here, I'll try to describe exactly how mirror symmetry works for K3s in a little bit after I get to the world sheet theory, but here the main effect of mirror symmetry will be to enlarge gamma parabolic to the entire 0420Z. Okay, so I haven't really told you too much about mirror symmetry yet. I've sort of mentioned that there will be, it'll be necessary to think about limits in the parameter space. But one of the key features of mirror symmetry is what it does to the cohomology of the mirror manifolds. So the Hodge group HPQ of X, which means HQ of the holomorphic, the sheaf of holomorphic P forms on X. Because I have a Calabi manifold, so I forgot to tell you what the S in SU is doing for me. So the S in SU means that I have not only a covariantly constant spinner, I have a covariantly constant holomorphic form. A covariantly constant form of type n comma zero, where n is the thing, but that turns out to necessarily be a holomorphic form. So because of that covariantly constant holomorphic form, it can't have any zeros, and it means that there is a natural isomorphism. So this uses the N0 form. There's a natural isomorphism to HQ of the pth wedge product of the holomorphic tangent bundle of X. And now mirror symmetry is going to identify this. So this is mirror with the qth power of the holomorphic tangent bundle of the mirror manifold. So this is one of the key properties. Of course, the whole point was I was supposed to do n minus p here because I used the holomorphic n form to establish this isomorphism between the n minus first wedge of the tangent bundle and the pth wedge of the cotangent bundle. And so here I'm supposed to get h n minus p. So that's h n minus p q of the mirror manifold. So only under very special circumstances will it be possible for you to get the same mirror manifold. You would have to have this kind of unusual symmetry in the Hodge diamond. So if you ask just about dimensions of vector spaces, you can make a kind of Hodge diamond. Here I might put H00, here I might put H10 and H01. So there's a symmetry, there's a left-right symmetry of this diagram, which is a consequence of Hodge theory, but in mirror symmetry, we're proposing a different diagram. So most, all manifolds have ones out here, right? But Calabi manifolds have ones over here on these corners in terms of dimension. And now I can imagine doing a sort of reflection around this axis. And that is the mirror in mirror symmetry. So the name was chosen to emphasize this property. So what happens for K3 surface is that this diamond looks like 1, 1, 1, 20, 1. There's some zeros here to completely fill it out. And so there's definitely a possibility. Not only do I have the standard Hodge symmetry, which would be a reflection around the vertical axis, but I can reflect in this mirror symmetry axis and interchange the roles of certain parts of this diagram. In particular, the H00 is somehow going to the H20 and vice versa from this mirror picture. So in fact, this kind of motivates, in the K3 case, looking at the entire cohomology of K3. And the entire cohomology of K3 is naturally a lattice if you put the correct intersection pairing on the 0 and the 2. So I'm going to let H0 pairs with H2 non-trivially. So this is a perfect pairing. And that lattice has signature, so the second cohomology had signature 319. That was what was responsible for the structure of the symmetric space I had before. But here I have signature 420. And that 420 lattice is the same 420 that's governing the story with 2A on K3. The 2B on K3 story is different. There's some other stuff going on with 2B on K3. I can't just describe it in terms of cohomology. There are additional parameters to be worried about. But if you remember my description of them last time, those parameters are another copy of the second cohomology, and so maybe the total cohomology, excuse me. And so I'm somehow doubling it. I don't know why, but I'm doing that. And I can still relate this basic mirror picture to get someplace. So I have an embarrassing admission to make. So last time I mentioned that I didn't think, I'd poked around in the literature a little bit, and it looked like people had not really checked the arithmetic group in the 2B on K3. Actually, it was checked, and it was a paper of mine many years ago with Aspinwall. Okay, so my main focus today is going to be on Calabi threefolds. And with this kind of background in mind, let me switch to the worldsheet version. Actually, Calabi of any dimension. So in the worldsheet version, this Hodge number identity and so on is closely related to properties of n equal 2 comma 2 supersymmetry in two dimensions. So remember, the story here is that I can do physics on this world sheet of the string itself. So I'm imagining a string propagating in time. And then a good approximation to this compactified theory is that the string has to map into spacetime. And I can sort of factor that map. I can do a projection and look at the part where it's mapping into the compact part of spacetime. And then I still have to worry about an effective string theory in the rest of spacetime, but the part in the compact part of spacetime is going to affect the answer that I get. So we're interested in projections into these compact manifolds, in particular into X, and making some kind of theory called the sigma model, just means a theory of maps from the worldsheet, the spacetime of the worldsheet, but the worldsheet into X. And the theories that we're looking at have quite a bit of supersymmetry. The n equal 2 comma 2 supersymmetry in two dimensions had all these various charge operators, which it was emphasized squared to zero and satisfied certain other relations. And let me just remind everyone of an example in geometry when you might get such operators. Namely, there are, on a complex manifold, or a Kähler manifold, I should say, there are round D and round D bar operators, and the ordinary derivative is the sum of these guys. So in complex coordinates, this differentiates with respect to the holomorphic coordinates, this differentiates with respect to the anti-holomorphic coordinates, and instead of using the usual real coordinates and its differential operator, you can use these things. And Hodge theory, which I won't review, is all about the behavior of these operators. But in particular, this group that I mentioned, HQ of omega PX, is also isomorphic to a cohomology with respect to the D bar operator at the PQ level. So the D bar operator is going to increase the number of anti-holomorphic differentials in your form. So D bar is going to take APQ to A PQ plus 1, and then you do the usual cohomology thing, closed mod exact, for the D bar operator, and that's called the Dobo cohomology group of X. It's the analyst's way of describing this algebraic quantity, HQ of omega PX. Sorry, this reminds me of one remark I meant to make when I was talking about Calabi manifolds in general. One of the great consequences of Yau's proof of the Calabi conjecture is that it's this existence theorem which tells you exactly which Kähler classes admit a Ricci flat metric on a Calabi-Yau manifold. And it also ends up predicting that for Calabi-Yau manifolds of dimension bigger than 2, in a strict sense that there are no holomorphic two forms on the Calabi manifold. The Calabi manifold has to be a complex algebraic variety. And so all of a sudden, we've got a new tool to study these possible compactification manifolds. We don't know anything about the metric in detail, but we do know how to write down algebraic equations which describe the geometric space. And we also know how to write down Kähler classes on those manifolds. And from Kähler classes, we can determine things such as areas and volumes of complex subvarieties, even though we don't know exactly how to write down the metric which generates those areas. We do know that the value depends only on the Kähler class, not on the details of the metric. So there are a lot of features of this compactification story, which is inherently about differential geometry, being sort of different positive signature piece of a general relativistic setup. But we turn it into algebraic geometry, and then we get to use the tools of algebraic geometry. And so this is another place where the analytic tools that you might use on this Kähler manifold end up being equal to some algebraic quantity that can be calculated using techniques, algebraic techniques from algebraic geometry. Okay, so this is why particular supersymmetric theory here. So the fact that so if I have a general Kähler manifold, I get a supersymmetric quantum field theory. And you can ask whether it's conformally invariant or not. And generally, it's not conformally invariant. So not conformal in general. We expect conformal theories for the world sheet theories of string theory. And there's a way to kind of measure what happens about conformality. So one of the important features of conformality is that it's a scale invariant theory. And if you change the scale of the theory, this wonderful thing called renormalization, Wilsonian renormalization, helps you understand how the theory behaves when the scale is changed. And in particular, this point of view about quantum field theories says that you should allows you to test the infinitesimal response to a scale change. And if you had a conformal theory, you would expect that infinitesimal response to be zero. So it's done perturbatively, and there's an RG flow on the space of theories, on the parameter space. Parameters here include a metric on x, and you can ask what happens under renormalization to a metric on x, and the answer is that there's a sort of first, yeah. So this is a quantum field theory calculation. It's a perturbative calculation, and it receives potentially corrections from every loop order in the theory, but the one loop approximation for this RG flow is what's called Ricci flow, letting the metric evolve according to its Ricci tensor. Well, if the metric is Ricci flat, so that the Ricci tensor vanishes, then the one loop approximation to the renormalization group is not going to change. So that does not tell you that the metric is conformal, because that was only the one loop approximation, but it does tell you how to sort of modify the thing to get to a conformally invariant theory. It was believed for a while in the 80s that actually there weren't any higher loop corrections, but that turns out to be incorrect. But you can modify the Calabi metric by higher loop corrections. You can. It is believed that you can by higher loop corrections to obtain a conformal field theory. So the basic way of producing a conformal field theory is to start with this family of Calabi metrics. Those are going to be one loop conformally invariant, and then you might, the dictates of the local quantum field theory might tell you that you need to modify the metric slightly. So that explains the interest in, from the world sheet point of view, in these Ricci flat metrics. If I take the sigma model with a target being the Ricci flat metric, and if I have sufficient supersymmetry so that I have this n equal 2 comma 2 algebra acting, then I can hope to understand what's going on. And in fact, there are now there's a sort of chiral and anti-chiral sector, and we can do it both on the left and the right, and study what are called primary operators. So if I look at the CC, the AC, the CA, and the AA sectors here, I'll end up with things like my HPQ, maybe the, okay, HQP, HQ of wedge n minus p theta, and H, maybe n minus p of wedge q theta, I'll end up with various groups, which, quantities in the two-dimensional theory, which you can identify with these geometric groups. It's natural that I'd be looking at the BPS spectrum of these various operators, d and d bar, as being natural here. And the fact that there are these various quantities and that they're labeling according to the geometry is a little bit ambiguous. Do I want the chiral to be the P or the anti-chiral and so on? That suggested initially that there might be this kind of mirror phenomenon, which did exactly what I'm saying here to the cohomology. So, so mirror symmetry on the world sheet was first studied a lot, and there were several steps. First of all, there's a nice construction for Calabi-Yau's, which are expressed as Fermat-type hypersurfaces. So what's so special about being a Fermat-type hypersurface? From the mathematics point of view, it turns out that the Hod structure on the Calabi-Yau can be factored in an interesting way. So just let me focus for a moment on the Calabi-Yau, the third cohomology of the of a Calabi-Yau threefold, which is given by the sum of xi to the fifth equals zero, I equals one to five in projective space. So that third cohomology turns out to factor in a funny way into a product of five spaces, lambda j, lambda 1 tensored up to lambda 5, each of which has a decomposition as if it were a Hod structure with two pieces. However, the p and q are rational numbers. And this decomposition is lost once you deform away from the Fermat point. So it's a funny property of Hod structures. It was actually noticed by people who study motives in algebraic geometry that the periods that you get at a Fermat hypersurface have this interesting factorization property, which can be interpreted as in terms of fractional Hod structures. Well, it turns out that this decomposition has an interpretation in the theory of two-dimensional conformal field theories as the CFT happens to be a product of what are called minimal model CFTs. And I guess here I want to do something, which is that I take this tensor product, but then I only keep the stuff with integer Hodge numbers afterwards. So it's a funny little projection. And here there's some kind of orbifold projection, which is a Z5 projection. On this tensor product of minimal models. So these minimal models have been studied extremely well. There's a classification of them. They actually are the one place where you can do representation theory of the superconformal algebra in some detail. There's something called the central charge of a representation, and if the central charge is small enough, you could actually sort of work out a representation theory. So there were these And this equivalence, which is called the Gutner correspondence, was quite well established. So there's a way of describing a particular world sheet theory associated to a particular hypersurface in terms of these minimal models. And then the mirror, and this was done by Green and Plesser in around 1990, the mirror turns out to be the same product of minimal models, but with respect, with quotient by a larger group. It turns out to be Z5 cubed. So that's just a little computation using representation theory of this n equal 2 comma 2 algebra. And so that suggested that there was going to be a geometric correspondence corresponding to this thing. So the original integer projection was simply, the original integer projection was simply getting you into projective space appropriately, but the second integer projection, this is z5 to the fourth, the second integer projection actually changes the geometry. And the proposal was that the mirror of the set of xi to the fifth equals zero in P3 is the set of sum of x5 equal to zero in P3 mod z5 cubed, where there's an appropriate diagonal action of the z5 cubed. Well, so this is a singular space, and so one should sort of resolve the singularities. And here, you calculate the key Hodge numbers for a Calabi threefold. H11 is the number of line bundles on the Calabi threefold, and when you have a hypersurface in projective space, the only line bundle that it has on it is inherited from the projective space. There's just one of them. But H21, which is the number of deformations of complex structure, is 101 in this case. Yeah, sorry, I meant to, I should have mentioned the role of two particular groups. So H11 measures the dimension of the Kähler parameters in this theory, and HN-11, if I'm doing dimension n, is the dimension of the complex structure parameters. And these are things which are going to be exchanged by mirror symmetry in the general idea. So when I discussed boundary points in moduli space, if I have a boundary point which corresponds to a boundary in the Kähler parameters on one side, then that'll get mapped to a boundary point corresponding to the boundary in complex structure parameters on the other side. Now, there's a small objection that algebraic geometers immediately raise, which is that these are real numbers and these are complex numbers. So here I have to complexify. And we already saw yesterday how to do that. You include the B field from the either the world sheet or the spacetime perspective. There's a corresponding quantity in the world sheet theory, which has to be included just like it was in the spacetime. So I have this complexified Kähler parameter space or the usual complex structure parameter space, and those are supposed to be corresponding under mirror symmetry. And here it was found that when you resolve the singularities, you ended up with a nice Calabi manifold which had 101 line bundles, but only one complex structure deformation. In fact, the complex structure deformation is not hard to identify. So the complex structure deformation is just to add a term, which is the product of the variables. And then this coefficient becomes the complex structure parameter. And the next step, and this is what got mirror symmetry so famous, was taken by Candelas, De La Osa, Green, and Parks. So they studied this family, and they studied the behavior as lambda goes to infinity. So I think it wasn't until this paper that it was really recognized that this mirror phenomenon was about appropriate boundary points. So the behavior as lambda goes to infinity here should correspond to something like large radius, large metric on the other side, on the original x. So this one is maybe what I'm calling x, and this is what I'm calling x hat, x check. And we should expect some kind of correspondence between these things. So it's at this point that the analysis of the physics started to really impact mathematics in an interesting way. So this paper was written probably in the fall of 90. It was circulated as a preprint, published in early in 91. In this analysis, as I've mentioned a few minutes ago, one should not just look at a semi-classical analysis, but take some kind of quantum, take into account quantum effects. Right now, I'm looking at it from the world sheet perspective, so the quantum effects that I have to look at are called world sheet instantons. And I'm really focusing my attention on a particular kind of parameter. In the mirror theory, the X check theory, I'm looking at the complex structure parameter, and it turns out that there are no world sheet instantons which affect quantities that depend on this complex structure parameter. But here, the world sheet instantons have definite effects. And so what's a world sheet instanton? Digression. You know, these are physical theories. They should be done in spacetimes with in two dimensions, one spatial and one time variable. But for a lot of the study, a Euclidean version of the theory is studied. These instanton effects are really about the Euclidean theory, and they have definite effects on the physical theory itself. This is something familiar if you've studied quantum mechanics or quantum field theory, where you see that this trick of taking the time variable and treating it as I times a spatial variable, and then looking for some things which make sense in that other system, that Euclidean system, produces poles in certain quantities which live on the imaginary axis in some space that doesn't have any right to be imaginary, but turns out to govern the physics through things like residue principles of what's happening along the real axis. So it's a very useful way to expand quantities to use this Euclidean thing. So the lots should mean that I take a world sheet sigma, which is now Euclidean, and is maybe a compact surface. And I should map that compact surface into my spacetime. I should take the action of the theory and evaluate that action by looking at the value of the action on this particular world sheet, and then maybe exponentiate that thing. Okay, sometimes there's a 2 pi I here, or it depends on your conventions. Exponentiate that thing and use that to, and now I should maybe sum these guys over all maps sigma or something like that. Well, summing over all maps sigma might mean integrating over all maps sigma. Typically will mean integrating over all maps sigma, but typically you could localize on minimum values of the action or something like that, and you would hope to actually get a count. So that's exactly what happens in this Calabi out case. You get some kind of count, and Candelas del Oso, Green and Parks made a very careful study of a quantity which they could expand here, which they could interpret as something which received corrections from genus zero curves, rational curves of arbitrary degree on this manifold, the original quintic threefold that they were studying. And they said, look, this has to be the way to count rational curves on quintic threefolds. And that's where everybody started getting excited, at least some of us did. So so the kinds of things that were being calculated on the left So let's see, I should change variables and use lambda inverse, but the things that were being calculated on the left were something like the integral of the holomorphic 3 form, maybe an integral of a holomorphic 3 form on some appropriate ratio of periods, similar to what I had for elliptic curves last time. And my holomorphic 3 form should be something like, it should be a dx1, maybe an x1, dx2 up to dx5, plus similar guys, divided by the sum of xi to the fifth, something like that, and the same integrand in the denominator, except I should also put in the parameter here. So I'm doing this calculation on P3 mod Z5 cubed. You don't really notice the mod Z5 cubed in the computation because everything is invariant under Z, the Z mod cubed. And I have to say that this was, for a while, a barrier to understanding what was going on. It was a barrier to understanding what was going on because the manifold and its mirror were so similar, so it was easy to get sort of tangled up about which one was being discussed where. But this is an integral being done on x hat, x check, really. And that was then expanded. It has a logarithm term, and then it has some kind of power series terms, some coefficients with powers of minus k, so this is near lambda equals infinity. Okay, so I'm slightly oversimplifying. You had to do a little something else to cleverly do the calculation, but there was some quantity which was built out of these period integrals, which had a logarithmic behavior, but then after the logarithmic behavior behaved like a power series. And these CKs, maybe after slight manipulation, having to do with multiple covers of rational curves by other maps, these CKs corresponded to the number of rational curves of degree k on the original manifold X. So that was their claim. So the state of enumerative geometry of curves on Calabi-Yau's, it was quite primitive at that time. In 1991, there's a C0 term. C0 is 5, which is the degree in this story. But then you get the numbers of rational curves of various degrees. So C1, 2875, had been calculated by Schubert in the 19th century. C2 is 609250, and that was calculated by Sheldon Katz in the early 1980s. I don't know the date. And then C3, one of the amazing things about this formula is that it didn't really have, you can analyze the formula and convince yourself that all those coefficients have to be rational, but they didn't really seem to have to be integers, and they all were integers, so that was great. There was a prediction for this third number, number of twisted cubics, and this is a problem which was worked out right contemporaneously by Ellingsrud and Stroma. And what you had to do at the time was a very delicate computation involving the Hilbert scheme of twisted cubics in P4. So you looked at that Hilbert scheme, you looked at all of the components of the Hilbert scheme, you had to evaluate the contribution of those components to this intersection problem, and after a lot of work you got a method, and then you wrote a computer program, and that computer program spit out an answer. So Ellingsrud and Stroma had computed this number. Candelas, Delos, Green, and Parks also gave a prediction for the number, they disagreed. So I like to say that this is one of the most fortuitous mistakes in the history of science. The fact that they disagreed meant that the mathematicians on one side and the physicists on the other side actually tried to listen to each other when discussing this problem. So there was a meeting at MSRI in May of 1991 to try to discuss this. It was half algebraic geometers, half string theorists. The string theorists convinced each other that Candelas et al. Were doing it right. The mathematicians convinced each other that Ellingsrud and Stroma were doing it right. We came away from that meeting with no progress made on the fundamental question, but for many of us, we started to try to understand what the other people were saying, and this really interesting partnership between algebraic geometers, particularly ones interested in things like enumerative geometry, and string theorists started at that point. The resolution of the story is slightly sad. So it's true that we were convinced that Ellingsrud and Stroma were doing it correctly, and they were, but in their computer program, there was one subroutine that initialized the counter at zero and another one that assumed it had been initialized at one. And when this was detected and corrected, their computation agreed with the physics computation. But if that had happened a few months earlier, actually things would not have gone so well because we wouldn't have talked to each other so well. So, so this spawned an amazing amount of activity. I think we've heard in this school from Lothar the sort of current state of it. People now have wonderful techniques for counting lots of things. They have not only, this number of rational curves didn't even have a proper definition at that time. It got formalized into what are called Gromov-Witten invariants by Koncevich and some years later, and not too many years later, within a couple of years, so that we now have what are called Gromov-Witten invariants, which are counting maps rather than images. And that's that slight manipulation that I talked about, that sort of get back and forth between maps and putative images. We then later had other invariants related to things like the BPS spectrum, which I'll come to in a little bit, Donaldson-Thomas invariants and so on, which are trying to count images a little bit more precisely, a little bit more directly, I should say. It's a great source of interesting ideas in mathematics. Now, this is one major place where the mirror symmetry ideas have made contact with mathematics. There are several other places, which I'm going to be talking about in my remaining sections. And one of the mysteries right now is how could we possibly relate this story to some of those other stories, to the SYZ story, to its Gross-Seibert version, or to homological mirror symmetry. It's kind of a dream of a lot of people to somehow extract things like these counts out of those other approaches, but so far people have not succeeded in doing that. Okay, so I think I'm going to leave any other discussion of enumerative stuff to the lectures that you already heard from Lothar. I should say that you can repeat the same idea. So if I use four variables and a quartic instead, I end up with mirror symmetry for K3s. This same computation doesn't really produce a direct prediction for something like the numbers of rational curves on K3s. In fact, that's not as well-defined a question. Here I should point out that there is a very simple estimate you can do for the dimension of the set of rational curves in a given class on a Calabi threefold, not just rational, any genus actually, and it says that the dimension should be zero. So here there are lots of things to count, at least in principle. Maybe there are some curves which actually do have deformations in spite of the naive dimension count, but there's an expectation that the numbers would be zero. And so there are things to count. In the K3 case, that's not true a priori. There are special K3s that have curves, or you can look at curves with nodes. That's an interesting thing to count. There are lots of interesting counting problems, but they're not directly produced by this. However, you can see how the moduli are mapped. So this green plusser construction with the product of the minimal models projected, something like that, for appropriate minimal models directly leads to what I mentioned, I guess it's gone, what I mentioned, the symmetry enhancement from the parabolic subgroup to the full SO420Z, that kind of mirror transformation. These mirror transformations also play an important role in the homological mirror story, and I'll come to that if I'll come to some part of the homological mirror story. Whether I do this part or not, I'm not sure at this moment. Any questions? Yes?
I have one question about is it mathematically important to find finally this Calabi metric, or just for aesthetical reasons? Because anyway, you can calculate so many things without knowing this Calabi metric. Is it useful to know it?
It would be really useful to know it, or to have better control over it. That one of the really interesting parts of this story is understanding not only boundary points where you have a mirror correspondence, but other kinds of boundary points where the entire Calabi-Yau manifold might collapse, or where some pieces of it might collapse. And if we model those collapses with algebraic geometry, we can make some reasonable guesses about what's happening, but to really know that that's what's happening in the physics, it would be great to be able to say not just that the area of this two-sphere is going to zero, but that the two-sphere is sort of uniformly going to zero in the metric, and the asymptotic behavior is doing something or other, right? So I really wish that we had better control over the metrics, particularly in cases where there's some kind of collapsing going on. And that's actually been a theme among certain differential geometers that's been studied pretty intensively in the last 5 years or so. They're really starting to zero in on this question of what kinds of limiting behavior can you get for these metrics. There have been numerical studies of the K3 metrics now, which are there's some software available. You can do some things, and there, as I alluded to yesterday, there's an extension of Yau's theorem by R. Kobayashi to cases with rational double points. So that's some of the collapses that we'd be interested in, but the numerical methods aren't good enough to say what's happening asymptotically as you collapse something. But you can at least sort of probe near the collapsed guy and see that the behavior is pretty reasonable, and maybe use that to formulate precise mathematical conjectures. So it would be useful. Okay, so the thing I want to say about mirror symmetry from the space-time perspective, well, I've already set it up that I was taking 2A on X and mapping to either 2A or 2B, depending on parity of dimension on the mirror. And I want to point out that this should extend to BPS states as well. So the place that we're typically getting BPS states in the type 2 theories is from these DP brains. So I want DP brains wrapped on appropriate submanifolds, Y in X, or Y dual in X dual. And I want to use the, I'm expecting to see a spectrum of DP brains on one side and a spectrum of DP brains on the other side, which correspond in some natural way. And they have, this correspondence has to be compatible with that change of Hodge numbers that I looked at already. So where am I going to wrap the DP brains to make sure that I preserve half of the supersymmetry? What I want for these cycles on which I'm wrapping is that they should satisfy themselves. Okay, so the tension of the brains, as discussed, has something to do with the volume of the cycle that occurred in a number of earlier lectures. On the other hand, the charge of the brain has to do with the integral of the Ramon-Ramon form, the appropriate Ramon-Ramon form over that cycle. So I should see some relation, some inequality, should not satisfy but saturate, excuse me, some inequality between the integral of the Ramon-Ramon form and the and the volume of Y. So fortunately, there is a very nice mathematical theory of differential forms on manifolds which admit some kind of relationship like this between the integral of the form over the manifold and the volume of the manifold. In fact, things which saturate that inequality are locally volume minimizing, typically, and it's the theory of calibrations, the Harvey-Lawson theory of calibrations. So quite independently of these developments and somewhat before it, they studied this problem, look for differential forms with this property that there would be some inequality between the value of the integral of the form and the volume, differential forms and associated metrics. And they made a list of cases, and most of their cases have something to do with a special holonomy situation. So I want to bring back my special holonomy board and decorate it with the calibrated geometry business. So, what are the calibrations? In the case of a Kähler manifold, the calibrations are the Kähler form raised to any power. And this calibrates complex submanifolds of dimension k. So among the manifolds that I can expect to find will be these guys. Now, that Kähler form encodes the information about the metric. And so I'm expecting to find a calibrated geometry story for complex subvarieties, which are themselves necessarily Kähler submanifolds, in the Kähler case. So that includes Calabi-Yau manifolds. So if you have holonomy SU, then you have holonomy contained in U. All I really needed was that the holonomy was contained in the unitary group in order to get the calibration story to work. So that's a place where I might have cycles that are in H even of X, whose classes are in H even of X. There's a special one in the Calabi-Yau case, which is that the holomorphic 3 form, or rather its real part, actually its imaginary part people usually write, but doesn't matter because you can always multiply the non-vanishing form by a complex scalar and change which part you're talking about. But anyway, this should calibrate what are called special Lagrangian submanifolds. And the special Lagrangians are n manifolds, real n manifolds, inside of X. And then, just for completeness, I'll mention that G2, which is another Ricci flat case, has two calibrations. There's a G2 3 form, and it's dual, and the cycles are called associative and co-associative. And I'm only mentioning this because there is some interest in physics in understanding better these two convectifications, even though I have very little say about them. And here I get a 4 form and a so-called Cayley calibration. So maybe I should call this 3. This guy by now is 4, and this is a 4 form. Okay, so the two cases of interest here are something involving the even cohomology, and here it's going to involve the middle cohomology, Hn of X, where n is the complex dimension, and whether that middle cohomology is even or odd depends on the parity of dimension, which is one of the reasons why there's a difference in the prediction about mirror symmetry here depending on parity of dimension. So what I want to do is wrap my DP brain around, for example, if I want to calculate the BPS particle spectrum in the effective theory, I'll take a DP brain whose spatial dimensions equal the dimension of my cycle. So it's either going to be a special Lagrangian half-dimensional manifold on the one hand, or it's going to be a complex submanifold on the other hand. And then I'll get BPS states in that way. And there should be some correspondence between these BPS states. So this basic idea that there's this interesting correspondence between calibrated submanifolds and the set of calibrated submanifolds in various cohomology classes in a mirror symmetry statement, that basic notion is going to be sort of the idea that drives the other developments of mirror symmetry that I'll be discussing. So I'm going to try to keep this board and that top board so that if we need to refer to this, we can. By that top board, I mean this top board, once I get it back to the top. Okay, so I want to talk about this very pretty construction of Strominger, Yao, and Zaslow from 1996. That's my point three. And it has to do with the behavior of those special Lagrangian manifolds. So there's a very nice theorem of MacLane, which says if Y in X is a special Lagrangian, then the deformation space of Y in X, so I'm looking at all the ways in which I can deform Y and keep it to be special Lagrangian, is smooth. The deformation problem is unobstructed, and it's smooth of real dimension B1 of Y. And this leads to the following very pretty idea of construction slash idea of Strominger, Yao, Zaslow. The idea goes like this. Suppose I take a Calabi manifold X, check, and I look at the 2A theory on X. Well, I've just told you that the D brains spatially wrapped on appropriate cycles should be giving me a BPS spectrum. So one of the types of D brain that I can do is I can take a D0 brain on a point, right? Saying that the degree of the zero cycle is one, it defines this to be a point. And if I look at the set of possible D0 brains on a point, so a point is a complex submanifold, there's not really an issue, that moduli space is actually, you can see that the parameter space for such guys is just the space itself. Those are points. So mirror symmetry is supposed to produce a mirror manifold, X, and this particular sector in the BPS spectrum should go to some BPS class on X. So how could you get a BPS class on X? You would take a D3 brain wrapped on an appropriate Y, a special Lagrangian Y in X, and we're expecting its moduli space to be a Calabi manifold, the mirror manifold. Now, I should have mentioned that the moduli space of a D brain is more than just geometry. So a DP brain has sort of two parameters. One is that there's supposed to be a location, and the other is that there's supposed to be a gauge field. So if I do this on a compact space, I should be looking not just at the deformations, the locations of the brain, but I should also ask about flat gauge fields, or anyway, gauge fields with some equation of motion on Y. And flat gauge fields on Y should be parameterized by, typically some kind of torus whose dimension is the first Betty number. And that complexifies those real parameters. So I'm actually going to find for this BPS class, a complex parameter space. And here, in order to get the dimensions to work, I should look at a case where B1 of y is equal to 3. So the proposal, which actually comes from doing a little bit further analysis of this situation, is that, so let me just put implies in quotes, if I take y to be a 3 torus, then the deformations of y could sweep out x. And then I'd be in this really interesting situation. So that's it's something like the fibration structure by elliptic curves that I was discussing before. I've got some parameter space for this guy, which I'm going to call S. That's some kind of 3 manifold. Typically, it's a 3 sphere. So I can decorate it with a 3 and be slightly ambiguous, but correct. I have X over S. The general fiber is a T3. But this will contain some locus, some kind of discriminant locus, at which the fibers degenerate. That's typically what you should expect to happen. Now, I should say that one of the things that we don't know is we don't have a clear argument about why this three-parameter space wouldn't allow the torus to meet itself after deformation, why it has to move away. There's some weak arguments in favor of that. So this is pretty... pretty hand-wavy, I have to say, at this point. But if you had this structure, then you would find a very clear description for the mirror. So I called it a torus whose dimension is this, but actually it's canonically a dual torus. So associated to this would be a family of dual tori. And by dual torus, I simply mean that I take as the fundamental group of the torus, I take Hom of the original fundamental group into Z. That's a dual lattice. Doesn't matter point by point, but in a family, it definitely matters. And so you would get different degeneration properties, potentially. But I would have a dual torus. And the proposal is that if you had the family of dual tori over the same base, that should describe the BPS space, which we know is X hat. So the SYZ proposal was, in its original form, was that you should expect that this structure, this very geometric structure, underlies mirror symmetry. You would expect to find, and I did it for 3 folds, I'm sorry, this wasn't restricted to 3 folds, but I fell into my usual assumption. Actually, I could have done it for Calabi, and I could have done the sort of underlying idea for any Calabi n-fold, although when n gets too large, I don't have the 2a, 2b interpretation anymore. So this is one of the places where we can go beyond the origins. I should have mentioned in the conformal field theory story as well, I'm not restricted to Calabi manifolds of low dimension. I can do the conformal field theory computations for arbitrary dimension, even though it doesn't have a string theory application. And here as well, you can make a proposal for Calabi manifolds of arbitrary dimension. So it should be fibered by special Lagrangian tori of half the dimension, and then the mirror should be produced by taking the dual torus. So this is really beautiful, and there's not a single example known of how to make this work in practice. And the problem boils down to, again, the problems of this calibrated geometry. So it's a really beautiful story that special Lagrangian n-manifolds are calibrated by the imaginary part of the holomorphic n-form, but there, I can say a little more. We do have a handful of examples of special Lagrangian manifolds. We don't have any that are 3 tori, and the most efficient way to build one is to look for a Calabi manifold whose defining polynomial has only real coefficients, and then look for real solutions to that defining polynomial, and that turns out to be a special Lagrangian submanifold with respect to an appropriate Calabi metric. That's the only systematic way we have of producing any, whereas we expect from this space-time argument, we expect really interesting families corresponding to the algebraic subvarieties on the mirror manifold. And we don't have any techniques for producing those or for studying them. So this is a place where we really need more tools from differential geometry or some other kind of geometry. We can't just rely on algebraic geometry. Yes?
Minimum order case is not technically under control in this
context. No, it's not. No. So the minimal model is about the associated conformal field theory, and this was derived by thinking about the BPS states in spacetime. That's right. So you could hope. That's right. You could hope to extend the minimal model program to account for boundary conditions of an appropriate kind. And there's certainly a lot of not the minimal model program, but the study of minimal models in CFT. There's certainly a lot of studies of CFTs with boundary behaviors associated to mirror pairs. I don't actually know if anybody's tried to match it with this picture. Yeah. Okay, so a small digression about this SYZ program. So the topology of how the SYZ vibrations work is pretty well understood in a very nice class of examples. So I should have said, I meant to say, that there's a vast generalization of this minimal model idea for world sheet mirrors, which was written down by Batarev and then later extended by Batarev and Borisov. And it produces combinatorial mirror symmetry description for complete intersections in toric varieties. And it makes clear, it helps you distinguish between the quintic and its quotient by that group because they live in distinct toric varieties in this particular case. And it's been investigated a lot, particularly from the world sheet point of view. And then I also meant to mention Hori Vafa when I was talking about the world sheet story, which is a mirror. It's a description of CFT mirror symmetry. In a form where the mirror is produced as a slightly different kind of conformal field theory, but one which describes adequately the mirror story, and which in many cases can be shown to be equivalent to the to one of the original type. So it produces so-called Landau-Ginzburg mirrors of sigma model mirrors, and it extends beyond Calabi. So although the origin of this topic was in this basic idea of string compactification, many of the formulations of it, even physics formulations of it, have extensions beyond extensions beyond the original context. So as I said, this Batarev and Batarev-Borisov constructions work in arbitrary dimension. The Hori Vafa thing works for Calabi manifolds of arbitrary dimension. This SYZ proposal is in arbitrary dimension. Now, the combinatorial description in toric varieties is suggestive and helps one make a sort of topological picture for the SYZ construction. So there's a topological picture based on this combinatorics. And let me just very quickly describe it for the quintic. So what I imagine is, so as I've stressed, I have to be near some kind of boundary point to make sense of mirror symmetry. And so what I imagine is that I'm near what I called lambda equals infinity before. So let me write it this way. So I imagine that, that's lambda inverse. So I imagine that lambda inverse is very small and that I'm near the intersection, I'm near a limit where I would just get a union of a bunch of hyperplanes in P3. So I would have these five hyperplanes in P3. I can take intersections of nearby of adjacent hyperplanes in P3 and intersect those guys in with the nearby quintic, producing quintic plane curves. So I get quintic plane curves, and then they meet three at a time in 5 points on each of these quintic curves. So I get some interesting collection of punctured Riemann surfaces by studying both the planes and their intersections, and the, intersecting everything with the nearby Calabi manifold. And the topological, and these fit together in this very nice diagram that's kind of hard to draw. I should have done it for the quartic where I can draw the diagram better. So for the quartic, I end up with 4 points on each P1, and they form a tetrahedron. And now I have to up that by one dimension to draw the picture for the quintic. And the story, the conjectural story, is that X mapping to S has its singular points sweep out this union. So these are singular points of the map pi. And that is the union of these punctured plane curves. And everywhere else, you should have torus vibration. And you can at least make elementary counts of things like order characteristic for the various varieties, and everything sort of fits together with the standard picture. Now, although this picture is motivated by the construction with special Lagrangians and the SYZ story, Gross and Siebert realized that there was a way to formulate a lot of what's going on in this kind of degeneration purely in terms of algebraic geometry. So the Gross-Siebert version is to use the data to use the data from one degeneration from a degeneration of Calabi-Yau's, and it has to be one of these special points that we're expecting to correspond to a mirror, to construct a degenerating mirror family, degenerating mirror variety. So they have a very nice program for doing this. It's completely compatible with what I just mentioned about the topology of the SYZ vibrations. But instead of using some underlying combinatorial structure to sort of see why there would be a mirror object, they're going to construct the mirror object quite directly from the data that they start out with. And they've been working on this for a decade. They have a very clear program, and many milestone results have been achieved. They haven't really quite finished it, but I'm confident that there's going to be really nice theorems which construct mirrors of Calabi manifolds from the type of data that we're discussing, and construct them in the sense of having a Calabi manifold that obeys all of the properties that one was expecting from physics, without necessarily, that obeys some of the properties one was expecting from physics, and having a pretty uniqueness, a nice uniqueness property of the construction, but without knowing that all the properties are satisfied. So I think a great thing which could possibly come out of this program, and which I know Mark and Berent would like to do, is to then somehow relate counts of curves on one of these Calabi-Yau varieties to Hodge theory data on the other, which is the original motivation. And I should say, we don't know how to do this in the SYZ context either. This is an interesting idea for producing mirrors, but if you sort of go back to that conformal field theory computation, we have no idea how to get curve counts out of it. But this is a very active area. Not so many people working on SYZ directly because of the problem of the technical problems of special Lagrangians. But this program is a very active area, and I have hopes for it that we'll have some understanding, pretty much directly within algebraic geometry, of why these enumerative invariants were doing what they were doing, motivated by the SYZ type of mirror idea. Okay, so I want to try to spend the last half hour talking briefly about homological mirror symmetry, which is another big stream of ideas that was motivated by this whole mirror program. Any questions before I launch into that? Yes?
The two programs are conceptually separated, right? So, I mean.
Between Gross Siebert and SYZ? Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, so SYZ motivates Gross Siebert, but now it's just an independent program, right? So I already mentioned the interest which Maxim Kontsevich developed in this mirror story once the Candelas et al. Computation had been made. So Kontsevich and Manin were working on aspects of this, constructing an appropriate space of maps, an appropriate mathematical structure which one could show gave invariants, these so-called Gromov-Witten invariants, for these spaces. And in at the 1994 ICM, Kontsevich made an interesting proposal, which was basically a mathematician's intuition abstracting from what was known at that time. And it's closely related to the story that I've told you about BPS states corresponding, but it predates it by 2 or 3 years. So it took a while for physicists to catch up, for physicists to actually see that there were D-brains around, that there might be a D-brain spectrum, and then took even longer to recognize that there was a version of this D-brain story which matches very closely with the mathematical intuition that Kontsevich had by just thinking about what the mathematical implications of this mirror idea might be. So so Kontsevich's conjecture is going to relate something to do with algebraic subvarieties on one manifold. I guess I haven't really committed. So I have X, which is going to be some complex manifold. And the sorts of things that I was mentioning over here, the things which would be calibrated by powers of the Kähler form, are subvarieties. But as I also indicated in the course of discussing the SYZ construction, there's a little bit more to the geometry of a D-brain, because the geometry of a D-brain should also carry the information of a gauge field, so there should be some bundle over this. So I should have a bundle, maybe initially a line bundle, but if you have a stack of brains, you could have a bundle of higher rank. You have a bundle supported on it on Y. And there's a natural extension of this. If you start to look at bundles supported on subvarieties, you're naturally led to think about coherent sheaves on the variety X. And what Kontsevich realized was that the natural setting for the conjecture he wanted to make was not just the abelian category of coherent sheaves, but the so-called bounded derived category that you would build out of that guy. So what Kontsevich is going to do on one side of the story is to study the bounded derived category of coherent sheaves, which is a, again, this is not historically correct, but can be seen as a vast generalization of the original notion of D-brains. Now, I just want to pause to mention the physics interpretation, which is now given to this side of the story, and that is that there's something called a topological twist, which you can do to various quantum field theories. This topological twist is really good at singling out things which might be studied well in geometry and being still related to the underlying physics. And when you look at the topologically twisted version of the D-brain states, you discover that there are natural ways of extending from just having a bundle supported on Y to having maybe a map between two bundles and something called tachyon condensation, which gives you a different state. And then later you realize that because in coherent sheaves, you can present anything as a co-kernel of such a map, that you were really talking about the category of coherent sheaves. And then the correct thing that the BPS states are capturing turns out, in a very nice argument about the bounded derived category, turns out to be exactly the bounded derived category. In fact, let me just interrupt myself for one moment and tell you one little connection between the bounded derived category and the physics. So, bounded derived categories scare lots of people. They have strange axioms. How in the world are you supposed to remember what a derived category is? You don't get to take kernels and co-kernels of maps anymore. There are just lots of strange things about the bounded derived category. So I personally heard a very beautiful lecture by Pierre Deligne in the spring of 1982 derived categories. And derived categories were quite new at that time, and he explained this famous octahedral axiom. He explained all the axioms, but in particular the octahedral axiom. So the octahedral axiom is some diagram that's an octahedron. Oops, I haven't done it right. Some diagram that's an octahedron, right? And you have maps here and maps here, and if you have those maps, then you have these maps and those commutes and whatever. So in that lecture, I really understood what the octahedral axiom meant. It was a fantastic lecture. And that understanding started to fade immediately after the lecture was over and faded for many, many years. But I now have a physics picture of the octahedral axiom, which actually makes it sort of easy to understand in some sense. So one of the features of these BPS spectra, which I haven't really mentioned, is that they are not constant as a function of parameters, and there can actually be these so-called wall-crossing effects where the BPS spectrum changes from one side of a real barrier, a wall in the parameter space, to the other side of the wall. And when you start to interpret these BPS spectra in terms of complexes of sheaves, which is the slight generalization that's gone on over there, you can start to ask the question, suppose I had two of these BPS walls which were intersecting each other, and I started here and I calculated the change in BPS spectrum. By the way, the change in BPS spectrum has to do with the distinguished triangles in a derived category. So long exact sequences replaced by distinguished triangle, where you go around and then at a certain point you shift up, which kind of is like the only remnant that's left of the long exact sequence. And which, so the role of a distinguished triangle in the D-brain interpretation is to tell you which of these states is a D-brain and which is a composite of other D-brains. And that information can change when you cross from wall to wall. So you need an exact triangle to sort of indicate what's happening when you go from wall to wall, and then there are BPS charges associated to the vertices, and they're slightly changing when you cross that wall, which is what causes it. So, but you can ask the fundamental question, what if I go here, and I go here, and then I reach this point in two different ways? Well, there will be some relation among the distinguished triangles that have to shift when I cross one wall and another wall, as opposed to when I cross the other way around, down and then over. And that relation is exactly captured by the octahedral axiom in the derived category. So if you didn't know about derived categories and you investigated topological twists of these BPS states, you would have arrived at the octahedral axiom on your own if you were sufficiently clever. But fortunately, that was done for us by that was an already existing structure, and it was one which Kontsevich was aware of and which he saw as the natural context to be using for formulating his conjecture. And then, this is the part of his insight which is just astonishing, given that the physics context wasn't really producing that yet. But he said what this should be dual to somehow is a mirror variety X check, which is a symplectic manifold. So I should point out that calling that one a complex manifold is focusing attention on the complex structure as deformations. Referring to this one as a symplectic manifold is focusing on the Kähler structure, right? So the Kähler form gives a symplectic form on any Kähler manifold. And more generally, so up there, it wasn't necessarily just about Calabi-Yau manifolds. Down here, it wasn't necessarily just about symplectic manifolds, although that's the original context. So you look at a symplectic manifold, and you look at Lagrangian cycles. So I don't put the special condition because I don't assume... Calabi-Yau, right, which is the only place where you have special Lagrangian, but you can still discuss Lagrangian cycles. And then there is something called the Foucaille category of X mirror, and maybe you should also take a derived category of the Foucaille category. When I say there is something called the Foucaille category, at the moment that Kontsevich made this construction, the Foucaille category had not been completely constructed. In fact, it was sort of 10 years or 15 years later that it was finally constructed. There's a 1,000-page book which has all the details. Not easy for people to follow. And just as in my story over here, where when I turned to the objects that were Lagrangian in nature, we don't know a lot of examples here. But Kontsevich's mirror proposal was that these guys should be isomorphic for a mirror pair, and that mirror pairs might well extend beyond the original Calabi-Yau context to other pairs of a complex manifold and a symplectic manifold in which there was an equivalence of categories between the derived category, the derived Foucaille category of one and the derived category of coherent sheaves on the other. Okay, so that's a conjecture which we don't have even the beginnings of a way to address. We don't know how to calculate this Foucaille category. It has been defined now, but we still, there's no single example where we can do much with the conjecture itself. But if the conjecture is true, it turns out to imply a lot of interesting structural things about this category which hadn't been known. And that's what the topic of homological mirror symmetry is really about. So this category has lots of interesting automorphisms. So one of the first things that was done was to find automorphisms of this category. Now, it turned out there were known automorphisms, and there's a really nice class of automorphisms which these days go by the name of Fourier-Mackay transform, which have been, it's based on the well-known joint paper of Fourier and Mackay. Hopefully everybody laughs, realizing that they lived in different centuries. So there are various variants of Fourier-Mackay transforms which are relevant here in finding automorphisms. And that's just one of the kind of structural things that have been pursued. There's just an awful lot now known and still under investigation about the bounded derived category, and much of it goes under the name homological mirror symmetry. So, maybe I'll do it here. Let me just mention the Fourier-Mackay transform for K3 surfaces. Which was actually the original context. So the idea is that if you have a bundle over a K3 surface, and you make some kind of moduli space of this type of bundles, then there can be a universal bundle. So this is a bundle over K3. over this moduli space of bundles. And now to to do something interesting, I'm not going to try to tell this story because I didn't write it down, and I'm going to get some details messed up. So I actually went through my notes a little faster than I expected to, and I can ad lib now, but I have to ad lib carefully. So maybe I will ask for questions and use that as a basis for my ad lib. Anybody have any? Yes.
Is there a notion of S-duality
that can be built into this? So the way that I'm describing this, I'm describing weakly coupled 2A and weakly coupled 2B, and I'm not really thinking about strong string coupling, if that's what you mean by S-duality. I don't...
Is there an extension of the... So, for example, I'll can you take the category you had and take the 2-category of that, and then take the derived non-derived category, 2-category, and say a strongly coupled version?
Yeah, all these homological guys love to do stuff like that, but I don't... Yeah, so you want a strongly coupled limit of the 2a on x.
For example.
Right?
And a natural way to do it might be to consider the 2
category. So I think I'm going to respond to that by mentioning a really interesting puzzle. So so where do the BPS charges live in this story? Well, the BPS charges are either going to live in the even cohomology of X or in the odd cohomology of X. They are essentially measured by how the BPS state responds to Ramon-Ramon forms. And in many senses, the even cohomology of X should probably be replaced by K-theory that's consistent with the bundle structure that I mentioned that the brains have to have. And there's a lot of evidence that the correct integral structure for the BPS charges is the K-theory of X. And then what you might want to do is take what's called K1 of X, which looks like the K-theory of X cross a circle, to be a natural partner for that. And you might expect some kind of, you know, correspondence between K groups in some version under a mirror symmetry. And in fact, when you write the Ramon-Ramon sector of this type 2 string theory, the type 2B string theory, in terms of in some natural form, it really looks like the K-theory is the right thing to do. If you do the same thing on 2A, you might think the K-theory is the right thing to do. But neither description in terms of K-theory behaves particularly well when you go to strong string coupling. So when you go to strong string coupling, in the 2A theory, the brains all sort of reshuffle, right? I mean, some of the brains turn into, I should have kind of mentioned what happens, but if you start with M2 brains, maybe I did do this. If you start with M2 brains, you can go down to the string or the D2 brain, and the M5 brain can go to the NS5 brain or the D4 brain. So you get and then of course momentum around the circle goes to the D0 brain. And there's a dual of that, which is given by a so-called Kaluza-Klein monopole, which describes the D6 brain. So the K-theory interpretation kind of unifies the brains, mixes up brain charges, says that K-theory is the way to go. But when you go to strong coupling, you somehow have to re-extract the information about individual types of brains and combine them with strings in funny ways, and people don't know how to do that very well. And similar story happens in the odd cohomology, where the D1 and D7 brains mix with other things. So D7 brains mix with other charged D7 brains. The D1 mixes with the fundamental string. The D3 brain stays where it was. And if those were supposed to be behaving like a K1 class, then we're sort of out of luck in terms of interpreting what it means for S-duality. So this K-theory point of view at weak string coupling is really good. It's very natural from the point of view of these categories. Also, I should say, there's a natural refinement of a Chern class map, which takes you to K-theory from the bounded derived category and takes you to K1 from the Fukaya category. So that all makes a nice picture. But then at strong coupling, it's really hard to understand that picture. So, if I could understand why at weak coupling it behaves as if it were K-theory, and at strong coupling, not only do the individual dimensions sort of pop back out, but they recombine in strange ways with other things, then I could maybe analyze your strong coupling question. Yes? So one of the problems I have with various mirror conjectures for tori is that in mathematical formulations, they have tended to focus on mathematical structures such as complex manifold or symplectic manifold. Even for K3 surfaces, this is a bit of a problem because the role of a K3 in string theory is to provide a metric for the intermediate compactification. But a metric has an entire S2 full of compatible complex structures. So a mathematical version of a mirror conjecture like that is not purely about the object that was used in string theory, but is about that object with some inessential extra structure added to it. And so for a torus, not every metric on a torus supports a complex structure. Not everyone, I can't even talk about the symplectic case if the torus is odd, but even in the even ones, to interpret that, I want a Kähler structure so that I can turn the metric into a form. So I think only for a subset of tori could I even really make sense of this. And so I don't know the answer, I should say that the derived category of coherent sheaves on an abelian variety, which is a complex torus with an algebraic structure, is not noticeably simpler than for other varieties. Well, maybe I will mention one last thing since it's kind of on the board and also on the tip of my tongue, easy to explain. That's an interesting fairly recent observation, which is that the fact that the integral cohomology is supposed to be K-theory, so the role of K-theory as the natural integer structure, plays a role in certain kinds of, back to world sheet, perturbative mirror symmetry calculations. And the story goes like this. One of the odd things about the mirror proposal, which was going to map H even on one side, and let me think about the integer structure again, to H odd on the other side, is the fact that there is a natural bilinear form on these spaces. In fact, that bilinear form is an essential part of having BPS charges on the thing. And so I have an intersection lattice, and I'm taking dimension of x, complex dimension of x to be odd. I have an intersection lattice in both cases, but this one is symmetric, and this one is skew symmetric. So how can I have a mirror transformation, sorry, I should call this X hat or something like that. How could I have a mirror that identifies these things and a symmetric pairing on one side and a skew symmetric pairing on the other side? Well, the original answer in mirror symmetry was let's just change the sign of the intersection pairing on the left depending on what degree of form I have in the H even, and that suffices to make it skew, and you know, it's not a real it's not a real pleasant way of doing it, but it's some way of sort of forcing a skew symmetric pairing without really understanding what you're doing. Well, one of the interesting developments, I guess I've neglected to mention this. So the ultimate outcome of the curve counting business was not just the creation of all of these invariants, but was actually the mirror theorem, which was proved by Giventhal and then again by Leon, Liu, and Yao, which explains that the method of Candelas et al. For predicting numbers of rational curves gives correct evaluations of Gromov-Witten invariants. So we got a definition of the invariant, and then we have a mathematical proof that the algorithm suggested by mirror symmetry doesn't really explain why there's a mirror manifold, but the algorithm suggested by mirror symmetry gives the correct answers. And one of the big ingredients there was an understanding of how this algorithm works and is related to hypergeometric functions, which are the periods of the mirror, but you can treat just as some kind of abstract, interesting kind of mathematical function, studied in mathematical physics a lot. And through careful studies of that, it came to be realized that there was a really interesting connection to this K-theory story, and it has something to do with the Herzenbruch Riemann-Roch theorem, which tells you something in K-theory. So if I'm using K of X instead, there's an alternate pairing. In fact, I'll use the part of K of X that comes from holomorphic objects. There's a natural pairing that you might have used given two bundles E and F. They're classes in K-theory. There's a natural pairing that you might have used which is just the Euler characteristic of the relative Euler characteristic of E and F, which means the sum of minus 1 to the I times the dimension of the X group E to F. That's just the definition. And the Herzenbruch-Riemann-Roch theorem gives you a way to evaluate that. It's the integral over the manifold of the Chern character of the dual, Chern character of the other guy, and then the Todd class of X. If that is the pairing that we're interested in, there's kind of a way to make it look like a pairing on cohomology. So the grading on cohomology, we're getting out of that n equal 2 comma 2 algebra in a natural way. So we should sort of keep the cohomology around. But the K-theory is seeming to provide, and it's got the right sign, right? It's a skew symmetric pairing, and it provides a very natural pairing. So there's, and the sign comes because of this dual in there, and so there's a sort of idea, which goes back to Mackay, of if I could somehow take a square root of this Todd class and do it in such a way that maybe it still made sense with the dual guy. So if I made some kind of linear map which involved the square root of the Todd class, then I would have a better understanding of how K of X mapped to HXZ and preserve this pairing, and that might have something to do with the whole mirror story. The reason it has something to do with the mirror story, by the way, is when you look at the periods, not just the quantities that were used in mirror symmetry originally, but the full set of periods, the exact question of how this pairing works actually shows up and affects the answers that you see. So the new development in the last few years, well, it was first observed by Anatoly Liebgober based on computations of Hosono et al., and his paper was completely forgotten and ignored. And then it was rediscovered by Iratani and by Katsarkov, Konsevich, Pontev. And it's something called the gamma class. And it says that there's a better thing to do. I won't just say better. There's a thing to do instead of exactly the square root of Todd, to put into that formula, which is completely compatible with the way that the periods behave under mirror symmetry. So the way to formulate this gamma class is to remember how the Todd class is defined. So probably very few people in this room have ever seen how characteristic classes are defined. If you have this is a characteristic class of the tangent bundle of X. And what you do for characteristic classes is you pretend that the bundle that you have splits as a direct sum of line bundles. You use the first churn classes of those line bundles. You plug those into some formulas, which are going to be symmetric in those variables. And then you take elementary symmetric combinations, and those are interpreted as higher churn classes of the bundle. So this Todd class is some expression in the churn classes of the bundle. And what I really need to do is tell you, so this is a so-called multiplicative characteristic class. I'm going to tell you a function of a variable. And then the rule for producing the class is to take the product of the functions of the churn classes of these imaginary, these postulated sum-ands, and then re-express that in terms of elementary symmetric functions. So you have to find appropriate functions. And the function for the Todd class turns out to be e to the minus z over 2 times I'm going to get the factor of z wrong. I think I've got the factor of z correct. Cinch. I'm probably missing a 2. I think it's z over 2 divided by cinch z over 2. I think that's right. Okay. Anyway, something very slightly like that. So now we want a square root, right? And the square root, well, the original formulation as done by Mukai and some other people was just to take a square root of this function. But there's something a lot smarter that you could do, which is to use a familiar identity about sine and to write this instead as e to the minus z over 4 times 1 over gamma of pi. Okay, so I'm going to mess up the pi's, but 1 plus gamma of 1 minus pi I z. So it has a disadvantage that I've just produced an imaginary function that no longer just has real coefficients, but that's okay. Nobody told me that my characteristic class had to have just real coefficients. Imaginary coefficients would be okay. And this imaginary coefficient turns out to be an advantage for interpreting the function that I need with that E check over there in that formula. So the proposal in place of the square root is to use this guy, right? E to the minus z over 4 times one of those gamma factors. Sine z, yeah, I've got it in the right place. I'm not sure about the pi. I think there's I might have a pi or a 2 off in that formula. So the place where this got where this showed up recently was some recent progress in understanding a class of two-dimensional field theories that's closely related to this mirror story that are called gauge linear signal models, which produce 2D CFTs representing that whole Batarev or Batarev-Borisov type class of Calabi manifolds. And in these, so there's been some recent advances in understanding the physics of those models, which lets you make the prediction of the number of rational curves directly without needing a mirror as an intermediary. But in the course of getting that prediction out, you actually needed to know that this gamma class was playing a role. So if this gamma class had not been there, it would not have been possible to extract the numbers of rational curves out of the recent story. But because the gamma class was there, we could actually do the extraction. Okay, I will stop right there.